Welcome. I am so happy that you all carved some time out to be here with me and some of my colleagues at PBS Wisconsin Education. My name is Mouna Algahaithi, and I'm the Education Engagement Specialist at PBS Wisconsin Education. During this webinar today, if you have any questions or comments or things that you want to add, feel free to add them in the chat box, which is right at the bottom of the screen. You'll see that chat box here, and I'll write hello. And you'll see an orange thing pop up on the bottom that you can click on and you can respond. And that's going to be a place for you to be able to engage while I'm sharing the incredible resources of Molly of Denali with you today. Just so you know, this is going to be recorded. So if you find yourself dozing off, which you won't, it's a fun webinar. You can always have access to it at a later time, and you can share it with your friends once we're all done. And if you notice me looking up at here, I don't have a mirror over here. It's just my notes. I want to make sure that I'm getting everything right. All right, so let's get started. I'm going to share my screen with you all. All right, Katie, can you give me a thumbs up if you can see my screen?
Okay.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, you gotta get dressed.
Let's get started.
No. You wanna get dressed? No.
I will also be muting all of you, just so that we can make sure that we can hear all the great content from Molly of Denali. And actually, Kristen, I'm gonna ask if you could mute everyone, please. Welcome to those who are joining. Alrighty, today we're going to be talking about learning with Molly of Denali. So what we're going to be talking about today is how informational text is a critical part of early learning and how it can be a valuable tool for learning informal and informal settings. You are going to discover how you can use the multimedia content, videos, games, books, to support children ages 4 through 8 in learning about informational text through Molly of Denali content. So what is informational text? Informational text is text whose primary purpose is to convey information. And note that text here includes written words, images, oral language, videos, and websites. And there's a really cute graphic over here that talks about the 5 different types of informational text. We have procedural, how-to, which teaches you how to do something. So for any of us who have ever read a manual or who have ever read a recipe, there's biographical, which tells us about a real person. There's functional, which helps us to do everyday tasks. There's non-fictional narrative, which shares and interprets a true story, and there's informative or explanatory, which conveys information about our world. Here's an example of what isn't informational text on the left. All you see is a photo. There's no information being conveyed here. And on the right, it is turned into a piece of informational text because there's that description added. The Common Core state standards list stories, drama, and poetry under literary text and not informational text. And that's something I also just wanted to kind of let you all know. So what do we want young children to know and be able to do with informational text? In addition to how this question is answered through the Common Core state standards, the Head Start Outcomes Framework, and the 15 learning goals of Molly of Denali, there is a PBS Kids Literacy ELA learning framework for children who are in preschool through grade 2. And you can see here how these foundational skills from phonological awareness to language, speaking, listening, and writing are infused and embedded into ready-to-learn content into this Molly of Denali series. So it's far beyond just entertainment. There are learning goals embedded within every episode that your students are watching and every piece of media that your students are interacting with. I look at this as almost a rubric, ensuring that this informational text curriculum is infused into the show. Now, let's meet Molly. Molly of Denali is an animated action-adventure comedy using a 10-year-old Alaska Native girl and her adventures in the fictional city of Kaya, Alaska. Produced by Boston's PBS station WGBH, Molly's community, Kaya, is filled with a colorful cast of characters who share in her adventures. There's Molly's best friend, Tui. He's over here. There's Grandpa Nat, who's over here, and he's a scientist. There's Trini, who just moved from Texas, which is awesome because we have somebody listening in from Texas today. And there's even Nina, who's an environmental journalist. And then, of course, we have Molly. Molly is resourceful and curious. She helps her mom and dad run the Molly of Denali Trading Post, which is a general store, a bunkhouse, and a transport hub. And she usually has her beloved dog, Sugi, by her side. We see Molly as an ambassador of informational text, and her character was designed to reflect that. The important thing to note is that Molly can't go on any of her adventures without understanding how to access or create informational text. Molly is curious. She asks a lot of questions. She seeks out information from all over, including the library, the internet, families, and friends. She's a natural fact gatherer, and she has a vlog because she loves to share that information with others. In fact, her Alaskan native name is Shanya, which means one who informs us. To give you a taste of this project a little bit more, here's the opening theme song. And I dare you to try to not get it stuck in your head.
Hey everyone, it's me, Molly!
Molly of Denali.
Let's go!
She's Molly of Denali.
By plane, a sled, or snowshoe, she is ready to explore. From Cactovic down to Juneau, always wanting to learn more.
Yeah.
Together with her best friend, Tui, always by her side.
And Trini!
Discovering the outdoors on adventures day and night. Come along with Molly.
Molly.
Who feels a fire we.
Come along with Molly.
Molly.
From tundra to the sea.
Molly of Denali.
Yeah.
She's Molly of Denali.
Come on,
let's go. Molly of Denali. She's Molly of Denali.
Yay. So what's all in the package of Molly of Denali? In addition to it being a television series, there are also a collection of digital experiences that you can find online. There are resources for educators and families. And like I mentioned before, it is infused with this informational text curriculum and an integration of Alaska Native values. Let's take a look at some of those digital experiences. The digital experiences include several games, and kids can find these either on the Molly of Denali website, in the PBS Kids game app, and in our new free standalone Molly app. And of course, all of these resources are free. For the website, they've also embedded these informational text-infused games in a playful learning experience, which is what you see a screenshot of over here. And this is an immersive, interactive, navigable version of Molly's Village of Kaya. And these are a couple of different examples of the games that can be played. And this is what the Mouna Denali website looks like. And we can get a chance to see those on the websites at the end if you'd like. One of the most incredible aspects of Molly of Denali is the authentic portrayal and inclusion of Alaskan Native voices. This is the first national children's series to feature an Alaskan Native lead and be grounded in the Alaska Native experience. PBS worked hand in hand with Alaska Native staff members, culture and language advisors, and consultants. There are also Indigenous voiceover talents, like you see two of them here. The girl who plays Molly is an Alaska Native herself, and her name is Sovereign Bill. And then there's also Sequoia, who plays Tui. And I just wanted to show you about a minute or so of this clip, which shows how that Alaska Native culture is infused within the show in a really meaningful way.
Sorry, Molly. The library doesn't have a record of Native names.
This is important information. There should be books about it.
I agree, but no one has written one yet.
I guess I'll have to go around town and find out for myself.
Good luck!
My uncle gave me my Nupiaq name, Sanaururuk. He who is good at making things. I was named after him.
Because you carve things out of wood.
Shakayakhe. It means Auntie Big Shot leader, and I am.
My name is Shoki, and it means bear's head, because I am strong, like a bear.
Atsuk, and it means berry.
Heen Shak, watches over the water.
Cool Donna, it means rose blossom.
Molly, I can't believe you made a book about native names.
Well, I had all this information, so I thought, why not make it fancy with a cover? And I even wrote a little explanation about what native names are.
Names are very important in the Alaskan communities. In the Kaya community, many people have two names.
Yeah, and see, I didn't just write their name. I wrote what it means and why the person got it and who gave it to them.
Can I keep this here at the library?
Really?
Yeah, I think other people would be interested in finding out about native names. You were, right?
Right!
Why are there blank pages at the end?
Okay, that was an accident, but a good accident, because now there's room if someone wants to add their native name.
A living book. I like it.
Thanks. And the best part? Nobody has my native name, which means I get to be called...
One who is amazing with animals?
Don't you like it? It's so me.
Molly, we're happy you want a native name.
But
it's just, traditionally, you don't name yourself.
Your native name is given to you, and the person who gives it is...
I got my name from my uncle.
I got my name from Shitsong, my grandmother.
My great-uncle.
Great-grandfather.
It's given to you by an elder?
Exactly.
I just thought that was a wonderful example of the way that Alaska Native culture is infused into the show. Here are some other examples of different Alaska Native values that are embedded within the show. Each episode usually will have one or two of these ingrained within the episode. And one of the most incredible things about this show is that it has been able to make a meaningful impact on the way Native people are represented on the screen. The collaboration with Alaska Natives has made the series more authentic. It has benefited the industry of children's media as a whole because it's building a more diverse talent pool that's creating content. And it's made the show richer by enabling us to celebrate and showcase a few values that are paramount to all Alaska Native cultures. These values, which you can see here, are woven into each piece of media, providing key social-emotional learning over the courses of the season. As I mentioned before, there are 15 learning goals that are integrated into Molly of Denali digital content. These goals are derived from the informational text skills, knowledge, and practices in the PBS Kids Literacy ELA framework, which I showed on the other slide. These goals address speaking and listening, as well as reading and writing of both written and visual texts. They address the range of informational text types discussed earlier, and there's educational research connected to each goal. You can see here the first learning goal, and this is one goal that must be satisfied through all the content. So, and I'm just going to read it out loud. To use informational text they access and or create to meet their needs and wants, including to help them solve real-world problems, to satisfy their curiosity, to take advantage of opportunities, to teach others, and to accomplish tasks. The other 14 learning goals cover a range of informational text and general literacy skills, including, but not limited to, choosing the best text for a given purpose, comparing and integrating information within and across texts, creating and improving informational texts, viewing texts as fallible, using a variety of text features to access or convey information, and of course, using strategies to understand texts, such as activating prior knowledge. I also wanted to talk about place-based learning just for a moment, because it's a way for you to use this content that may speak about a culture that seems far away, but provide a localized perspective. We are currently living on ancestral Native land, and for many students, that may be a wildly new concept. Place-based learning connects learning to communities and the world around us. It immerses students in local heritage, cultures, landscapes, and opportunities, and uses those as a foundation for learning. Some example of questions that you can ask some of your students is, on whose ancestral lands do we live today? Who are our tribal neighbors? Why do my neighbors have different ways than my family? And I'll give you an example of a resource that you can all check out after the webinar, which is Wisconsin First Nations, which is a great resource for those of you who are living in Wisconsin who might want to learn more about the First Nations who are living near you and might want access to resources to learn more about those nations. To access that, you can simply go to wisconsinfirstnations.org and feel free to ask questions, or we can chat more about this afterwards. So let's get into some of the specific examples of educator resources that you can utilize. Via PBS Learning Media, you can find lesson plans and teaching tips for teaching with digital game. You'll also find background reading on Alaska Native culture and informational text for young learners information. Additionally, you'll find resources that connect school and family learning, as you can see here. To give an example of this, the Alaska Native advisors and producers worked together to, and when they did, they came across aspects of Alaska Native life that were key to various cultures living in the United States, or in Alaska. One of those key aspects of life is dog mushing, a mode of transportation that Alaska Natives have used for hundreds of years. The next three examples demonstrate how the producers created a multi-platform learning experience around dog mushing by exploring the subject via the multiple learning goals. In this clip from Welcome Home Balto, Molly demonstrates learning goal number 9, which is to get kids to generate mental pictures or images while reading or listening to text.
Hmm? What's this? An old book. Balto.
Seriously? You found my Balto book? I thought I'd lost it forever. Oh man, I used to love this book. I really wore it out.
Who's Balto?
He's a dog. Was a dog, like a long time ago. And not just a made-up dog, he was real.
So why did they write a book about him?
Because he was a hero.
Can I borrow it?
I love books, and I love dogs. So a book about dogs? I'm there. It's in pretty bad shape, but I can read it to you.
Well, since the pictures in the book are in bad shape, I'll just make the pictures in my head.
In the town of Nome, Alaska, there lived a Siberian husky named Balto. Balto was a sled dog who became a hero in the year 1925. The children of Nome became sick that winter, and the town had run out of medicine. So a shipment of medicine was sent from Anchorage, Alaska by train. The train made it as far as Nenana.
Hey, I've been to Nenana. Me too.
So I'll pause it there. I'll leave you in suspension. You'll have to watch the rest of the clip later. Picturing the story piqued Molly's curiosity about what happened to Balto after his journey. And so she goes to the library to find out more, and what she imagined to the real hero. Here's an example of an accompanying digital media piece, Sled Dog Dash Digital Game. Because sled dogs are such an important part of Alaska Native culture and history, the producers wanted to make sure that the focal theme of one of the games wanted to make mushing the focal theme of one of the games, and thus developed the game Sled Dog Dash with a veterinary advisor that specializes in sled dog care. Players go on a dog sledding adventure to deliver items to Grandpa Nat. They pick their dogs, drive their team, and avoid obstacles along their way. At checkpoints throughout, players use the app to find the information they need to care for sled dogs and get to Grandpa. You get to feed the dogs, dress them in winter gear, and keep the sled in good shape. Having Molly and players use an app allows us to model digital informational text to our students. This focus on mushing also includes a printable that allows students to build their own dog sleds at home with detailed instructions, as you can see here, where they make a dog sled adventure playset. And one of the amazing things about this content and about all of most PBS Kids content is when they have these different printable ideas for you to do at home or with your students, it's very often very low-cost materials, many of which many families will have on hand. So if you notice here, the materials include scissors, an empty cereal box, and tape. And of course, you'll also find teaching tips that explain the game in detail and how to play it. They give you different teacher preparation ideas, and they explain the game thoroughly so that you're aware of what it is you're about to ask students to be doing. In another episode called Reading the Mud, we explore how Alaska Natives have learned to read the land around them for clues on how to track animals for food and to avoid danger. In this story, Molly and Tui must use a field guide of animal tracks to ID the prints of a missing turkey named Trouble and find its location. The clip we're about to show is the point in the story which demonstrates learning goal number 7 to crack the case, to compare and integrate what they already know, background or prior knowledge, with information provided in a text when reading, listening, and or viewing. And just for the sake of time, I won't be playing this clip, but in this case, Molly combines her knowledge from muddy footprints she has seen in the trading post at the start of the episode with what she has learned about tracking animals in order to find the turkey Trouble. Fishing is also an important part of Alaska Native culture, with fish caught for a purpose and not for sport. The community only takes what it needs. In the game Fish Camp, players fish for salmon using a rod and reel, or a device called a fish wheel. A book on Alaskan fishing provides the information that kids need to know, such as identifying characteristics of different types of salmon, what hook to use, or how to find the best spot to fish on the river. Fish Camp focuses on learning goals around text features, like flow diagrams and captions, as you can see from these screenshots. The game also teaches kids the Alaska Native value of respecting nature by limiting their catch to what they need. And here's an example of the teaching tips that accompany this game as well. Another example of an activity that you could assign for your students is Molly's Field Guide for Birds. You can see here, this is a downloadable that you can easily download and send to your students. And she has some examples of some birds that she's taken notes on. So the American robin, what it sounds like, where it lives, its habitat, interesting facts. And there are also some extra pages where students can go out and try to track birds of their own. The last set of examples focus on the Alaska Native tradition of beading and procedural text. In an episode called Valentine's Day Disaster, Molly and Trini race to create a beaded surprise for their friends and family. However, they neglected to follow the instructions, which led to a bit of a disaster. The animated episode focuses on procedural text and teaches children how to recognize how text can be organized sequentially. And this live-action interstitial builds on this theme. So I'm just going to play about a minute of this.
Hi, Molly.
We're in Mentasta in Alaska. We're going to bead necklaces today. Beading is a way to learn our culture. These are instructions for beading necklaces. Step one, choose your colors.
These are the beads.
Red bead, a black bead.
And right here is a feather made out of bone.
Step two, tie a knot. Step three, use a piece of moose hide to keep the beads from coming off.
Moose hide is really tough.
So that was just an example. And there's an accompanying game as well, which highlights procedural text in the context of beading. Players learn about the tradition of Alaska Native beadwork as they create beaded designs by following instructions for patterns created and passed down by Molly and her family. They can also create their own original designs in the game's create mode. They gather materials and stitch intricate designs for use on items like a hat to give to Molly's friends and family. The game includes a variety of procedural text to help Molly complete her task, which include material lists, numbered steps, images of final patterns, written description, and each is parsed just in time to allow players to use the text to complete their work. We address a number of other learning goals through procedural text, such as developing children's ability to use key details in text. So those are just a variety of the three resources that I wanted to focus on. And I will show you in just a little bit how you can explore the resources and where you can find them. So now we have about another half hour, and this is the point where I kind of go back to you, and it's completely up to you on how you want to use this time, whether you want to visit the Molly of Denali website on PBS Kids to explore the games, if you want to check out the different teacher resources on PBS Learning Media, there's the link there. And then there's even another cool tidbit, which is the Molly of Denali podcast, which is audio from the show, in case you want to find a way to incorporate that into your lesson. And then, of course, there's also my contact information there. So I invite you now to kind of ask questions in the chat if you have any questions that I could answer. And I'm also more than happy to kind of show you how to use the website and how to get around the website as well. So I'm going to open the chat. And like I said, now's a chance. If there's anything specific that you would like to see, feel free to add that to the chat and I can, or unmute yourself, and I'd be more than happy to answer any questions. I see, what is the podcast? I will open that up and I'll share my screen again, actually. So I'm going to click on Molly Denali podcast. And like I said, it's really just audio from the show. So you can find 9 kind of clips of audio here from when the show first came out back in May last year. And it's just a way in case maybe you didn't want to show an episode, but maybe you wanted to find a way to infuse this into your lesson. It's just a way for students to hear the audio, follow along on some of her adventures, but without actually watching anything. So you can see these different, the first 9 episodes here. And they're all about 11 minutes long. You're welcome.
What I like about the podcasts, Mouna, is that students can practice listening comprehension. So much of what we learn from listening to people speak or present. So that's a great use for the podcast. Mm-hmm. I see a question, Mouna. Do we have free access to the podcasts?
Absolutely. All of these resources are completely free. This here, I just clicked on the PBS Wisconsin or PBS Learning Media link, which, by the way, I will send you all of these links that I mentioned here in a follow-up email. But this is where you can access the media gallery of digital media content from Molly of Denali. So in this collection, you can see the metadata here where there are 3 interactives, 3 lessons, or I'm sorry, 4 lesson plans, 3 documents, 10 videos, and it even shows you the age range as well. And so here you can find a specific lesson plan if you were looking for specific ideas, or if you wanted, or if you watch a specific clip that you wanted to integrate, you can find some different here. Here's a sled dog dash game that I mentioned, and the beating art game. Here's access to that field guide for birds. And even a recipe book that has some of Molly's family recipes, and it has space for students to be able to write maybe some of their own family recipes.
Mouna, we have another question from Renee. Renee writes, is there a specific age range or group of students this is really geared towards?
That's a great question. These are typically geared towards students who are 4 through 8. A lot of times when I do community engagement with this content, though, siblings younger and older are just as engaged as children who are in that age range, though. So I really think that there's flexibility to make this a little bit harder for those older students, or to create, you know, more difficult learning comprehension around some of these learning goals as well. I think you can totally do that. And then I'll also show you what the pbskids.org website looks like. And you can see here, again, access to the podcast here, activities, games, and videos. And these are some nice printables, whether they're coloring sheets. This one is a maze to help Molly get through the maze to get to her dog, Suki. And this one is drawing a line between different animals in Alaska and identifying those different animals. And again, completely free. There was just a new game released called Veggiezilla. So you can see all these different games. And it's really cool to know that these aren't just things that you can plop your students down in front of for them, you know, to pass time, but that there are learning goals and there is an informational text curriculum embedded into every single piece of this content, of these different content.
Mouna?
Yeah.
There is a great question from Christina. I can read it to you, but I think if you read it yourself, it might be easier for you. Yeah. For everyone else, I'll read it.
Okay.
Do you have recommendations on how to tie what Molly teaches us about Native Alaskan culture to Native Wisconsin cultures?
Mm-hmm. My recommendation would be to, one, find what First Nation lives near you, right? So for example, I'm in Madison, so I would try to get in contact with somebody who works in the Ho-Chunk Education Office. And I believe that it would be really important to work, if I was going to do some sort of lesson where I wanted to incorporate Ho-Chunk culture authentically, I would try to speak somebody from the Ho-Chunk Education Office to make sure what I'm doing is respectful and is appropriate. And so what I recommend is visiting WisconsinFirstNations.org. And I'll get there by going to PBS Wisconsin Education's website. I'll show you how to get there. So it's just pbswisconsineducation.org and clicking on Wisconsin First Nations. And I think this is a great place to start looking into that. Because like I said before, with Molly, she's talking about Alaskan culture, and we really want to personalize it so that students don't create this sort of dissonance where they're thinking, oh, well, that's Alaska, that doesn't happen here, or there may not be Native cultures here. We want to make sure that as educators, we're doing our part to honor the culture that is around us as well. And so Wisconsin First Nations would be a really great place to start with learning about where are the current tribal lands near me, and to kind of get you into knowing about, well, where are, who are some people that I might be able to come in contact with to help guide my lesson plans. And I also wanted to point out, we have a Wisconsin biography series as well, which would be for those older students. Kristen, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's middle school, right? Wisconsin Biographies is for middle schoolers.
You're half right. Wisconsin Biographies is created for students in grades 3 through 8. The fourth grade academic standards are what it was modeled around. However, where you're absolutely right, Mouna, is that teachers that work with older students in middle school are using them in their social studies classroom. And there are print biographies that teachers are using with older students.
Mm-hmm. Another thing that I would do if I was going to introduce, you know, Native, especially local Ho-Chunk culture into my classroom is I would see if there are any books that talk about Ho-Chunk culture or even Wisconsin Native culture, which is really hard to find. But there are these Native consultants who love to share the books that do exist. And that's why I highly recommend reaching out to the education office, the education tribal office near you. And that's what I've done in the past when I'm doing an event where I would love to have somebody from the Ho-Chunk Nation come. I invite them or I ask their input, and they've been really helpful.
Hey, Mouna, could I share my screen?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm going to pbswisconsineducation.org, clicking on Wisconsin First Nations. And if you aren't sure whose tribal lands you live on, notice where my cursor is. It's by this link called a map. In this map, you can show the counties and cities in Wisconsin. So Mouna and I are here in Madison, and that's why Mouna is referencing the Ho-Chunk. And if you're up here in Hayward, your neighbors would be Ojibwe. And to find content, notice I'm clicking on the resources tab. And I can search for resources. I can search by treaty land. I can search by Ho-Chunk. I can search by grade level. I can even search by resource type, including books, lesson plans, and websites. So that's how you can start to find content for your students. And if you look at the lower left-hand corner of my screen, there's a red rectangle that reads Contact Us. Any questions that you have, feel free to reach out to us. We know that sometimes educators are a smidge nervous about teaching this culture because they want to get it right. And so if you have questions, please contact us. We work very closely with David O'Connor at the Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction. And we work very closely with the University of Wisconsin, with Aaron Birdbear from the University of Wisconsin. I'm also going to show you at the top of the website here, there's an FAQ tab. And it's frequently asked questions that you might have about teaching about Native American cultures in your classroom. And then finally, there's an exemplar tab that features videos of teachers teaching Native American culture, history, and tribal sovereignty in their classroom. Thanks, Mouna. I'll stop sharing now. I'll quit hijacking your webinar from you.
No, thank you. I appreciate that. That was helpful.
If I can figure out how to quit sharing. Aha, I've got it. Back to you all.
Chris said, the ways videos are helpful, I often use them with my 4K students in the classroom.
And 4K, interesting, great.
I see somebody raise their hand. Did you want to say something? All I see is numbers, so there's not a name. Well, for those of you who are curious about the ways, I can also show you that from our homepage, PBS Wisconsin Education. You would just click on the ways here. And these are stories from Native communities around the Central Great Lakes, so beyond just Wisconsin. And you can show videos here, different stories. And they come with discussion questions over here. You can view where the First Nations live on an interactive map. And of course, there's more context added in this description below. If you'd like to share, I would love to hear more about how you use this in your 4K classroom.
Mouna, will you click on the Stories tab at the top right?
Yeah.
And will you click on the living language, bottom right-hand corner. So I have a story. When I taught third graders at Thanksgiving, I had a mom come in. Her daughter was Native American, and her mom really wanted me to help kids in her third grade class understand the culture, but also to recognize how similar her daughter, Haley, was to her friends. And so this is a piece, had it existed, that I would have used because it's showing Native American life in, I believe, Shawnee, Wisconsin.
Thank you for sharing that, Kristen. So yes, here's another really great resource that you can utilize, and I'll be sure to include that in the post-event email for you all.